Today I'm going to introduce a mini-series on the obesity paradox. When thinner means sicker and heavier means healthier. This is actually the cover from a book by Carl Levy. Dr. Levy is a physician, and he's not a lightweight, emotionally driven, this is what I think of the world kind of guy. He's a heavyweight academically. He's written several articles on this issue. He's an endocrinologist, and this was an article that I'll cover again later in a summary video. But this is in Nature Reviews for endocrinology. As you see, he's the front author. actually, let's go over a couple of items out of that journal, and then we'll finish up with a couple of other comments and even a bottom line on this issue, which comes out of key points in this article. So what we're talking about is healthy obesity versus unhealthy lean. There's a paradox there. This was in, as I said, Nature Journals 2015. He makes a couple of points. We're getting fatter in the U.S. as well as most of the rest of the world. And controversy has surrounded the idea that some individuals with obesity can be considered healthy with regards to their metabolic and cardiorespiratory fitness. That's been termed the obesity paradox. The controversies are reviewed in this article, and they discuss programs on patients with obesity who have no metabolic abnormalities and who have preserved their fitness. Now, the article also suggests the greater emphasis should be placed on improving fitness rather than weight loss per se in primary and secondary prevention of cardiovascular disease, at least in patients that are moderately overweight and have class 1 obesity, that is a BMI 30 to 35. The morbidly obese clearly need to focus priority on weight loss. So that's part of the issue here. It's this whole question of which is more important, weight loss or getting in shape. Now, if this sounds weird, again, this is a big discussion. This article touches on it as well. And I'm just going to read a couple of points about this one. One of the clues here is the journal that it came from and the name of the journal, the Journal of Cachexia, Sarcopenia and Muscle. Now, it's also a review and facts and figures. I'm not going to go into details on that one. But the reason I said the title of the journal is a clue, Sarcopenia and Muscle. This is not, if you've seen other videos of mine, this is not the first time you've heard about sarcopenia and how dangerous it can be, especially for people over 65. Well, wait a minute. What's sarcopenia? It's muscle loss. And again, I'll put a reference to these articles as well as this video in the description below. And what you see here starts to become much clearer. You remember in that series, basically what we said is when people lose muscle loss or lose muscle mass, they become unhealthier. And so this thing about, oh, well, he's just a little old man or he's just a little old lady, especially talking about people 65 and older, that's not just a little problem. In fact, I did another video where we talked about docs tend to miss that. 90% of the time, they just think, well, you know, that's a little old lady. That's not good. This is a problem. And again, there is a major overlap between this question of the obesity paradox and what's known about the lethality of sarcopenia or muscle loss. And again, you see it in this image here where a 25-year-old with mostly muscle in his thigh versus a 63-year-old with much less muscle and still the same thigh circumference, but a significant amount of fat there. Now, in other videos on this topic, I'm going to go into a thing called Mendelian Randomization studies and a meta-analysis of Is cardiovascular, I mean, is obesity actually really linked to heart disease? Now, what does that mean? We know what a systematic review is. It's a meta-analysis. It's the sort of things that you review with Cochrane studies. But Mendelian randomization, here's what Mendelian randomization is, and we explain that further in the in that video. I think it'll come out next month. There are certain things that you can't do a randomized clinical trial on. For example, does obesity actually cause heart disease, or is there something related to both of them? First of all, you're not going to do a randomized trial where you have a study group that you make obese at random, and a control group where you're not obese. And here's the second thing. You can't do that. Even if you could do that, which you can't do, you're not going to blind people to it either. I mean, you can't blind the patient or the subject to the fact that you've made them obese. They'll know it. So will their doc. So Mendelian randomization takes advantage of the fact that genetics tends to be randomly distributed. If your mom has blue eyes and your dad has brown eyes, there's some random component of which you're going to get, what eye color you're going to get. But again, as you can see, that can start getting really deep. That's not for this video. We're just going to wrap up on this video to go back to LaVie's study in Nature Reviews Endocrinology. And he brought up some key points, which I think will help bottom line this issue of the obesity paradox. The prevalence of obesity has increased in most of the world over the past few decades. Patients with obesity have more cardiovascular and metabolic risk factors than people with normal weight, and have increased risk of developing cardiovascular disease. Now, data suggests that the metabolically healthy obesity, especially when combined with a high level of fitness, is associated with, at most, a minimal increase in overall risk of cardiovascular diseases and mortality. And again, this gets much more important as we get older, into our mid-60s and beyond. In patients with established cardiovascular disease and other chronic conditions, such as kidney disease, severe arthritis, those with overweight and class 1 obesity have a better prognosis than lean patients. That's the obesity paradox that they're talking about. Now, many of us, myself included, will automatically start thinking when you read that point, well, there's clearly going to be an association with a severe disease like kidney disease, severe arthritis, as when that's coupled with cardiovascular disease, and clearly these are maybe the lower BMI, the thinner people are selecting for people that have significant illness. And yes, that's part of this question as well. That's part of what happens when you start digging into the studies and the data. Now, the last two points I think are very, very important here. And again, the last one itself is the bottom line. Fitness is more important than fatness for long-term prognosis, again, especially for older folks. In the obesity paradox, fitness markedly alters the relationship between adiposity, or how much fat you have, and long-term health outcomes. So it's critical to exercise. High-intensity intervals, resistance training, and other things like some endurance training. But the first two are most important, high-intensity intervals and resistance training. Now here is the bottom line on this entire obesity paradox. So you can, those of you who say, Brewer, just bottom line it, don't confuse me with all these facts. Here's the bottom line, guys. Despite accumulating evidence on the obesity paradox, the available data still support purposeful weight loss for long-term health, particularly when combined with increased physical activity, muscle strength, and fitness. So again, we'll get a little bit deeper and go into some interesting and maybe geeky things like the Mendelian randomization. But if you've made it this far, Again, I appreciate your interest.